good evening. You probably all know someone who has cancer or someone who died from cancer. But what you maybe don't know is that 90% of the people who die from cancer actually don't die from the first tumor they get. This 90% of the people, they die from tumor relapse, meaning when the tumor is coming back after they were cured, or from metastasis, meaning when cells from the first tumor go to other organs and you get actually cancer in other places in your body. So the big issue that we have today is that we don't have efficient therapies against metastasis and tumor relapse. And that's actually what my team is trying to do, making new therapies so that these patients can survive. But before we can generate new therapies, we have to understand how cancer works and what cancer actually is. And so, as you probably know, cancer starts with cells of your own body, such as this cell here from a breast. And these cells can get mutated and become cancer cells. The mutations can come from a lot of places in the surroundings, such as tobacco smoke or UV from the sun, or viral infections, or from irradiation, from a lot of things. But they can also be encoded in your genes. So usually I get the question, what's my chance to get cancer? Obviously I don't have the answer, but for 65% approximately of the patients who get cancer, actually they were predispositioned. So it's actually because they got this already in their genes. It doesn't mean that you have to smoke and to stop putting sunscreen, because for 35%, actually you are responsible or the environment in which you live. But so coming back to this cancer cell, what is the main difference between a cancer cell and a normal cell of your body? Well, actually, a cancer cell is continuously multiplying, proliferating, as we say. And this cell is multiplying until you have a tumor. And we have some good strategies to kill cells that are multiplying. You probably all know chemotherapy and radiotherapy. So these are really specific treatments that will only kill cells that are dividing. But the issue is that in your body, a lot of cells are dividing, not only the cancer cells. For example, the cells in your intestines are replaced every 4 days. So if you get these treatments, you actually get very sick. Your keratinocytes from your hair are continuously proliferating. That's why with these therapies, you lose your hair. And there's also another thing, is that actually cancer doesn't look like a bulk amount of cancer cells together. A tumor is much more complex than that. Actually, you have to think about a tumor like a new organ that is formed inside your body. And in this tumor organ, you obviously have cancer cells, but you also have blood vessels coming inside the tumor. Because cancer cells, like all other cells in your body, they have to survive, so they need oxygen and nutrients. And you also have in your tumor organ immune cells, cells of your own immune system. And these cells are there to protect us against diseases, for example, bacteria, viruses, but also against cancer cells. And so the immune cells, they actually have three main functions. So the first thing that immune cell has to do is to recognize the invaders, let's say. For example, bacteria, viruses, but also cancer cells. And it's not that easy to recognize a cancer cell, because actually a cancer cell is just a mutation version of your own cells. So sometimes it looks really like your own cells. Then the second function that your immune system has to do is to kill the invaders. It's actually quite a racist system, let's say. And the third thing is that your immune system has to generate memory so that the next time you get the same virus, the same bacteria invading your body, you don't get sick, but you can immediately eliminate this invader without getting sick. That's actually also the principle of vaccines. So the fact that you already induce an immune reaction against something that you will then potentially have and you won't get sick about. So we now know that we have a lot of immune cells in our tumors, but we really have to know what these cells are doing so that we know how and what can we do with these cells. Can we use them? Can we kill them? Can we make vaccines out of them? And to know what a cell is doing, to know their function, This is actually dictated by the proteins that are expressed by the cell. So a lot of proteins can be expressed. Proteins can be used by cells to move, to interact with other cells, to kill other cells. And to know the proteins that are present in a cell, this is actually dictated in your DNA, in your genes. And all of our cells have DNA, obviously. This is extremely long, it's 2 meters long, approximately, and a lot of genes, 25,000 genes, can be expressed in each cell. And so we just need to know which genes are up-regulated or down-regulated, so which are on or off. And these genes can then, the DNA can then be transcribed in RNA, and this can then be translated into proteins. But what we want to know is which genes are present in the tumor. That's a big question, but a tumor, as you know, is a mixture. We can already now, we have technologies to know which genes are present in a tumor, but that's maybe not the most interesting question. Let's, for example, because it's science and cocktails, so I decided to also talk about cocktails. So I have here a very nice cocktail. I tasted it. It's extremely good, but something is missing. So there is something that is not ideal, optimal. If I want to do something to alter this cocktail, I have to know what's inside. Obviously, I taste that there is maracuja, I see the ice cube, but I don't really know what other ingredients are inside. So it's much more interesting to know which genes are encoded in each ingredient, to know, to understand each ingredient separately, rather than to understand the whole cocktail. So we now can know which genes are expressed in tumor cocktails, but what we want to do is know which genes are expressed in the separate ingredients of the tumor. So there are new technologies created by other scientists who enable to, from a mass of cell, separate all the cells. These are water in oil emulsions. So for example, here is a video. And you can see down here, these are immune cells that are pushed in a liquid inside a tube with oil. So what's happening is that actually you will have little droplets of water, and in each droplet you will have an immune cell. And so that's a mechanism to separate all cells, and actually then we can use the technologies we already have to detect all genes in this single cell. And so to recognize the genes, because at the end you want to know which genes belongs to which cell, we will add some barcodes. We put, this is not really working. So we put the cells in one side, we put little barcodes, and then you will have little droplets where you have a cell, where you have the barcode. We will assess all the genes of this cell, and at the end we will know which genes belong to which cell. So if we come back to the cocktail, actually what we need to do, once we have used this technique, which is called single-cell RNA sequencing, using bioinformatics, we will be able to actually not only know which ingredients are there, but we will also know how much of each ingredient is there, and we will also know, like for example, the maracuja and the lemons, they're closer together because they are fruits, while the alcohols are a bit higher, the ice is in the middle because there is water in all these ingredients. So actually using this bioinformatics, we will be able to put some ingredients with similar genes together. And that's actually how a tumor looks like when we use this technology. So each little dot you see in a color is one cell of a tumor. So this is a lung tumor. And so now using this bioinformatics, I don't know how it works because bioinformaticians are doing this for us. But we can regroup the cells in what we call clusters. And so then we know, okay, you have immune cells there, other types of immune cells, you have cancer cells. So you can really know from each cell types what's there, how many are there, what are the genes that are expressed, and so what are these cells doing. So let's go back to our scheme. So what we found already a lot of years ago, so a lot of scientists have discovered this, is that in a tumor, you have dendritic cells, the general of the immune system. This is actually the type of cell that is giving the orders. It's also the cell that is really good in recognizing invaders, foreign material. And then there are also T cell soldiers, as I will call them. These are the cells that are really good in killing. And so now it's important to know how these cells are actually working together to kill the cancer cells. So what's happening when you have a tumor? So actually, you have the dendritic cells, the generals, that are all the time floating inside your body until they find something strange, something that doesn't belong to your own body. And these dendritic cells will then actually, when they see something which is strange, they will take a little piece from this cancer cell. This is called a tumor antigen. They will take this little piece because they need to transport this information to the lymph nodes, which are actually their headquarters. And in these lymph nodes, the dendritic cells, the generals, they will actually show to the T cell soldiers, like, this enemy has invaded our body. So that the T cells exactly know what's the enemy, they can take the right weapons, and the T cells will actually then start to multiply to form a T cell army that is specifically dedicated to kill the invader that the dendritic cell has recognized. So this is also something that you know, because for example, when you have a pharyngitis, probably some of you will have it now, you might have your lymph nodes here that are really swollen, and these are actually your T cells that are starting to proliferate, the soldiers that are being recruited, so these can go back and kill your virus in your throat. So same is happening in the lymph nodes near a tumor. Once the army is formed, the T cells will go back through the blood to the tumor site, and there they will be able to kill the cancer cells. More material of the cancer cells will be released, more dendritic cells will come to activate the cycle, and actually the cycle will go on and on and on until all cancer cells are dead. So it's quite good news to know that we have a good immune system in our body. And actually, maybe some of you by now, you don't know it, but you have maybe some little tumors in your body. You will never realize it because your immune system is just super active and is killing these little tumors, luckily. But the problem is that people still get cancer, people still die. So there must be problems in this cycle. It's not perfect. And I will name three problems and discuss three problems today. One of the problems is that the T cells, the soldiers, are sometimes not really well activated. They are not doing their function. Another problem can be that you have good soldiers inside your tumor, but they can't do their action. Someone, something in the environment is inhibiting them. And a third problem could be that actually the tumor was never recognized, that the dendritic cells didn't initiate the whole cycle. And to find solutions against this problem is what we will use immunotherapy. Immunotherapy is actually a very general word that just means boost your immune system to fight cancer. So if we go back to the first problem, well, actually, what we know is that T cells, the soldiers, you don't want them to go in overdrive in your body because these can be harmful. These are killing machines. It can be dangerous that these cells go in overdrive because they can also kill important tissues. And to make sure that these cells don't go in overdrive, our body has made mechanisms. And one of these mechanisms is the fact that these cells can express proteins on their surface, such as PD-1. It's what we call an immune checkpoint. But the cancer cells, they take advantage of these mechanisms. Because they know, so this PD-1 is actually a break. If this is bound to the right ligand, the T cell will lose their weapons. So what the cancer cell will do, they will express the ligand so that it is bound, and so that the T cell thinks that he has to drop the weapons and will not kill the cancer cell anymore. So there are very smart people, such as Jim Allison and Tasuku Honjo. They got the Nobel Prize of Medicine last year, who found immune checkpoint blocking therapy, the most known immunotherapy, which is actually used now in Belgium. It's also paid back. And so what they thought is, if we inhibit this reaction, this binding, then the T cells will keep their weapons and still be able to kill. So they made little molecules that would make sure that this interaction is not taking place so that T cells can continue to work. And this is really effective, not in all types of cancers, not at everyone, but we really see every day better results using this immune checkpoint therapy. But that's really nice, but still it might be that once your T cells are still very active and are starting to kill the cancer cells, well, actually the T cells are suppressed by the environment, the tumor they are in. The reason, therefore, is because in your tumor you also have bad immune cells, such as these guys, macrophages. So it's really annoying because when we look, for example, to our single cell genes, we can actually see that a lot of cells in this tumor, all these cells in the middle, are these bad guys. So sometimes you have more bad cells of your own immune system in the cancer than good immune cells. So we call these macrophages TAMs, from tumor-associated macrophages, the macrophages that are in the tumor. And you can also look at them via fluorescence. And for example, here, this is a breast cancer. And here you can see in this breast cancer, all the little green things are the macrophages. Actually, in this tumor, you have much more of the macrophages than the cancer cells themselves. And if we now study how important these macrophages are in the tumors, well, what we saw is that if you have a lot of these cells in tumors, actually in all cancer types that are in red here, it's really bad for your outcome. So in all these cancer types, breast cancer, brain cancer, nearly all cancer types that exist, if you have a lot of the macrophages, you have not a good choice to a good chance to survive. Now we're thinking, why are these immune cells that are supposed to protect ourselves acting bad in our tumors? And actually what we saw is that there are two types of macrophages present in your body in general. There is the M1, the one that arrives first, and the M2, the second one. And what they actually do, well, these M1 macrophages, if you, for example, have, let's say, a skin infection, a bacteria that is causing something in your skin, what you want is you want to kill the bacteria very, very quickly. So your immune system will call the first macrophages arrive, and they are really killers, not specific, they just kill everything what's around them. So that's good because your bacteria will be dead, but it will also damage your tissue. And in a tumor, it's actually very good because these cells just arrive, these M1 macrophages, and they kill everything, so they kill the tumor. But we know, so our body knows, you don't want to have this killing mechanism for too long, because otherwise you will just have a hole in your body. So what you want is that you have a second wave, once the bacteria is dead, of macrophages that will actually help to heal the tissue. So they will actually make sure that your tissue is healed, they will eat all the dead debris, they will clean everything, they will make new blood vessels so that everything is clean again. And so this is really bad when you have this happening in your tumor, because these cells are actually just healing your tumor, making sure that the tumor is continuing to survive. So obviously this M1 is, in immunology, nothing is black and white, or green and yellow. And so probably what we find in tumors is something which is in between. But this is a good working mechanism to understand this. And we have been really interested in how these M2 macrophages, these bad macrophages, are actually helping cancer. So there are different things that these macrophages can do. First of all, they can suppress the T cells, the soldiers. They can make sure that the soldiers are not killing cancer cells anymore. And also, because these have as a goal to heal the tissue, they can also generate new blood vessels, something which we call angiogenesis. And the problem is that, first of all, if they make new blood vessels, the cancer cells will get more oxygen, more nutrients, so they will survive better. But also, they make these blood vessels very, very, very quickly. And it's actually a bit like the road works in Belgium, not quickly, but the fact that if you do something too fast, It's not stable, it's full of holes, and it breaks down quite quickly again. And so the cancer cells, they see these new blood vessels full of holes, and they think, oh, cool, let's just jump into these holes and travel with these blood vessels to other sites of your body. And that's one of the main issues, because that's what I talked about in the first sentence. This is what we call metastasis. So when your cancer cells go from the first tumor to other sites of your body. So these M2 macrophages are really bad. We really need to get rid of them. So we studied them a lot, and what we saw is that actually in tumors, you have both types present. You have the M1s that are here, you have the M2s that are there, and we also saw that they come from the same parent cell, which we call the monocytes. So what we want to do, so these are the bad ones, two options, or we just try to eliminate this with novel therapies, or we try to make sure that all these parental cells that come inside the tumor don't become these M2 macrophages, but become the M1 macrophages, because these are good guys. And so what we thought is we will really look to the genes that are expressed by these M2 macrophages, to the proteins that are expressed, and we found a marker, something which is distinguishing them from all the other cells. And such a marker was called MMR. And it's a bit like, for example, in the cocktail. This cocktail is actually a little bit too sour because there is too much lemon in it. Now we know that there are a lot of lemons inside. So we want to kill everything which is yellow. And so what we made is something specific against the marker, which we call, it's actually a protein, it's a nanobody. So this entity, we couple it with radioactivity, and this will actually only bind to the cells that are expressing the marker. So we found actually a treatment where we can only label these M2 macrophages with radioactivity. And then we can use this for a lot of different things. We can make radioactivity coupled to it that kills the cells, but also that shows us the cells. And this is, for example, an image of a mouse in which we use these little molecules. And so everything which is red, yellowish, like this here, is actually these M2 macrophages. So here you can clearly see that this mouse has a tumor, and that in this tumor, there are a lot of M2 macrophages. That's really interesting because we know from literature that if you have a lot of these M2 macrophages, chemotherapy will not work. So actually it's good to know upfront, will a patient respond or not to chemotherapy, because you know all the side effects that are there. So it's really interesting to know if a patient will respond or not to a therapy. And so this is done on a mouse. And actually, we started doing this on patients last month. So now we have the second patient in the clinic where we can really see, okay, this patient has a lot of macrophages or not, so this patient can get this or this therapy. Okay, so we have ways to specifically show these macrophages and also to kill them. But sometimes it's more elegant if you can just push everything that's coming in to the good cell. We also try to see what's actually making this cell becoming the M2 or the M1. Actually, I spent 5 years trying to unravel this. Now I know everything what is not involved in this process. But we also finally found what is important for this process. And it's a marker which is called CSF1 receptor. It's a protein. Actually, when this protein is bound, well, all the macrophages will become this M2. So here again, we use the same strategy that has been used by a lot of different groups. When we inject something that binds that on this receptor, well, you will be able to inhibit the binding, and you will actually push all the M2s to the M1s. So there is also a way to make sure that the parental cell become only the good cell. So that's also quite nice, because now, first of all, we can make sure using immune checkpoint blockade that the T cell will function well. And there are also strategies developed by us, but also by a lot of other people, to make sure that once they are in the tumor microenvironment, they are not blocked by the immune suppressive microenvironment. They can still kill the cancer cells. But to have these T cells working, you have to initiate the cycle. So you need dendritic cells that function well. And this became lately my favorite cell type. It's a very nice cell type. But before we started working on these dendritic cells, well, actually what we saw is that in literature, these dendritic cells were also always depicted as bad cells that were not able to recognize the cancer cells, that were not able to migrate to the lymph nodes, these headquarters, and that were also actually inhibiting the T cells to kill the cancer cells. But we didn't want to believe this. We thought, this is a bit too easy. We will really look to the dendritic cells present in the tumor. And what we saw is actually we have three types of dendritic cells present in a tumor. So obviously, the next question we had is, what are these different types of cells doing in a tumor? So we wanted to see which step of the cycle can they perform. What we saw is that actually the three types of dendritic cells were able to recognize cancer cells and to take little pieces of the cancer cells. So all of them were good at it. But then when we looked who can migrate, who can travel to the lymph nodes, well, only two types of dendritic cells were able to do this, being these CDC1 and CDC2, as we call them. And then when we looked to who is actually capable of showing pieces of tumor cells to the T cell soldiers so that they can start to proliferate, well, it was also only these two cells that were able to do this. So this means that T cell type, the MoDC, well, is first of all not able to do this, but is actually also inhibiting T cells. So it's also making sure that the T cells will not work. And that's really important to know because a lot of dendritic cell-based therapy are using this first cell type. So that's why by now these treatments are not really working well, because we just took the wrong cell to do it. That's why it's really important to know which cells are present and what they are doing. But so the good message is that, okay, first of all, the bad message is that one of these cell types is actually bad, is also inhibiting the T cells, the soldiers to work, and is actually behaving like a macrophage. So we don't want T cells to be there. But the good message is that we have cells, two types of dendritic cells, that are being present in our tumor and are always trying to protect us. And when we look at these cells, actually we can find them back. They are very small amounts, but very potent. And we studied these cells in a lot of different cancer types. And we saw that in all the models in mice we used, lung cancer, colon cancer, melanoma, they are always present there. So you always have good cells in your tumors that are protecting you. We also looked a lot to patient samples, to lung cancer, to colorectal cancer. Now we also have data from glioblastomas, brain, skin cancer, breast cancer. We always find these good cells back. So that's really good news because maybe we can use these good cells like a cancer vaccine, for example. And that's what we tried, first in mice. So when we inject cancer cells in a mouse, well, a tumor will grow. But when we will first vaccinate these mice with the good dendritic cells, for example, the CDC ones, these dendritic cells, they come from the tumor. So they know the tumor antigen, they know the enemy, so they can give these messages. If you first vaccinate the mice, the dendritic cells, and you then give a tumor to the mice, well, then actually your mouse is protected. And then we tried also to know what is happening. What we saw is, for example, this type of vaccination works really, really well in melanoma, in skin cancer, and we saw that we got much more T cell soldiers. So that's actually very interesting because that means that we can generate some type of anti-cancer protection. We also did it with a second type of dendritic cell, the CDC2, and the other good one. And when we did this, well, actually we saw that this also worked, but the mechanism was different. It was in other types of cancer. It was in cancers where you had a lot of these macrophages. And actually we saw that this worked well in lung cancer. We also now know that it works well in breast cancer. And actually what was happening is that all these bad guys, so the macrophages, were down, so they were absent. And so what's the main idea of our therapy? So we know that these dendritic cells can generate protection for long term. They can generate a memory. So let's say we have a patient, that's a bit, let's say the future dream, but we will make it work. We have a patient, what's happening now, let's say this patient has a lung tumor. Well, the tumor is surgically removed by oncologists. This is something which is already happening now. So what we could do is to specifically isolate the good dendritic cell that we identified and give this dendritic cell back to the same patient as a personalized therapy, because this dendritic cell is very specific in recognizing the cancer of this patient. So if we can give back this dendritic cell to the same patient, first of all, this dendritic cell will be able to recognize the very small metastases that are present in the patient, because usually in a lot of times, you don't find the little metastases, and these are the ones that can regrow. And secondly, if you give this to the patients, this patient will generate a memory against your tumor. So actually what will happen is that you will have a memory against cancer, and so you will not relapse anymore. And this is really important, because when we talk to patients, and for example, we have a lot of breast cancer patients, one of the issues that these patients have, once they are cured, is when will it come back? And will I be able to fight it again? And how worse will it be? So we really hope that in a very near future, we'll be able to use this therapy, because now it works really well on mice, but we don't know yet whether it works on patients. It takes a lot of time, as a lot of scientists already know that science takes time and money. So we really hope to put this in the clinic very soon, as soon as possible. And to just illustrate you how potent these dendritic cells are, I got some slides of one of our collaborators from the UZ Brussels, who is called Bart Nens, who is using dendritic cells not coming from the tumor, coming from the blood, so they are a bit less specific. But this is just to illustrate how well they can work. So this is a patient that entered the hospital some years ago. And these patients, as you can see, so all the black things here are tumors. It was a patient, a very young woman, with melanoma, so skin cancer. And all the black things are metastasized. So little tumors that came from the skin and went to the lymph nodes. So first of all, this patient got the normal, the conventional treatment that is trying to kill the cancer cell. It worked a bit, you can see the tumors are regressing, but then it came back. And then this patient got here the dendritic cells, and it didn't seem to work at the first sight. And what's really difficult, and I'm very happy that I'm actually not a medical doctor, so what the medical doctor had to reply as a question coming from this patient, so it was a very young woman, was, can I have children? Because she was 27 or so. And the doctor said, no, your health situation is not fully stable yet. Maybe you should wait some more years, because now might be risky. What actually he had in mind was, no way, because you will die. Well, actually, the good news is that this dendritic cell therapy worked. And as you can see here, all the tumors are gone. And several years later, and the patient is still alive, this was a picture that was received by the doctor. So there is really a high potential in the dendritic cell therapy. This is actually an exception, but the goal of my team is to make it work in, hopefully, all the patients. What I want to end with is to thank my team. These are all the people who generated the first results together with me. And usually, I was always saying that this doesn't look like a nice... I mean, these people are very nice, but this doesn't look like a nice picture. I would prefer the picture to have it like that. But then, actually, 2 days ago, we made a picture of our team, and I think we're really improving, because that's a team now. So let's just continue on this way. What I just want to end with, because a lot of people tell me when I present data, yes, but you just said 65% of the cancer are in our genes, so we can't do anything. It's statistics, so really try to live healthy lives. It's easy to say. I'm also super stressed and I am drinking alcohol. But try to do your best and educate your kids to know what's good and bad in life. Do some sports, eat healthy. And also, if you know patients in your surroundings, now you know how hard the battle is inside, but also mentally, just support these patients because they might need you. Thank you.